maybe we can reintroduce. We have with us today Dr. Luis Antunes, and he's an associate professor of digital communication at La Escuela de Comunicação de Arte, Universidad de São Paulo. His line of research is called Datacracy, analyzing the growing influence of data sciences and digital networks in governance and social sciences. Luis's master's degree was on hypertext systems and his PhD on digital identities on a fluid, fast-changing linguistic context. Since 2012, his research group started working with innovation groups inside the university and with public administration of the city of Sao Paulo, with the goal of developing interface initiatives for smarter cities. And Verda Cunha Pascalin is also with us. She was born in Sao Paulo in 1975, graduated with a bachelor's degree in communication in 1996 and a master's in communication and consumer practices in 2015. She's also, let me say something about your entrepreneurial activities. She started her own company on the management of cultural and social projects and has been doing that. But she's now a member of the research group Datacracy, with Luis, at the School of Communication and Art of the University of Sao Paulo. And she's about to start her PhD in communication at the University Complutense de Madrid.
Yes. thank you.
Welcome. Thank you. I'm going to sit right here and hold up these signs.
Okay. Okay, thank you. Thank you very much for coming, and I'd like to thank for the collaboration with this research. I believe that it wouldn't be possible without her, without the members of the group. What we are talking about here is how we build the identity of a city. Because there are cities that are really appealing. When you talk about London, Tokyo, New York, everybody thinks about them. When you think about the US, you think about three or four cities, or maybe 10 cities, not much more than that. When you think about Japan, you think about three cities, not more than that. Spain, two cities, not much more than that. So why are these so appealing? And we know that the crime rates, and we know the pollution rates, we know the sound pollution in smaller cities is so much better. And more than that, we know that they rank worse in quality of life when compared with neighboring cities. So why do you live there, and why don't the services, the small cities prosper, while the big ones shiver and die because they are unlivable? But this is not what happens. They thrive and they have become specialized workforce magnets. Most of the population, most of the world population today lives in huge cities, and they leave the small cities, go into the big ones, and while the small ones are getting smaller and smaller and smaller. So this, we compared two rankings, the Numbeo and the World according to GAWC. This first ranking ranks cities on labels like alpha, beta, etc., alpha plus plus, and we got some alpha cities, both New York and Raleigh in the US, in the US rank as alpha plus plus, both São Paulo and Curitiba in Brazil, both Mumbai and Pune in India, both Barcelona and Malaga in Spain. And you can see with the Numbeo data of quality of life that Raleigh is almost twice as better than New York, that Curitiba is almost twice as better than São Paulo, that Pune is very better than Mumbai, and Malaga is a lot better. But nobody talks about these cities. Everybody talks about those ones. So what happens? And we also know that not all cities are ideal for everyone. Now imagine that you are recently wed a couple with a small kid. You won't want to live in San Francisco because San Francisco is very expensive. You won't want to live in a huge city because you probably have to adjust your schedule to go into hospitals, schools, and things like that, and traffic is terrible. So how can we make this situation a little better? Well, We know that cities are people magnets, but excessive concentration is a true problem. When we see huge cities, exactly like São Paulo, Tokyo, etc., we see that they are all of them facing infrastructure problems. Of course, if you are in a poor country like Lagos in Nigeria, the infrastructure problems will be much worse than the infrastructure problems that you see in Tokyo. But they will be problems. How do you deal with sewage? How do you deal with trash collection? How do you deal with logistics and things like that? Meanwhile, small towns are being emptied. In Spain, it's a true fact, in Portugal, and in most of Europe, small cities are struggling to keep their inhabitants, and everybody's running to the big ones. So how can we reverse a bit of this process? Well, first we know that city identity is essential. We always refer to people when coming from cities, not from countries. It's very rare you say someone, oh, he is Spanish, Calante. People say, he comes from Madrid, he comes from Barcelona. People say, he comes from Sao Paulo, from Rio. People say, he comes from New York, San Francisco, Los Angeles. It's very hard to say, you're talking to a Parisian. If you're only talking to a French guy, if he's not Parisian. Because if he is Parisian, you're not talking to a French guy, you're talking to a Parisian. And the same happens to Buenos Aires and all other cities. So how do we do that? We believe, since we came from a communications background, that cities have to develop their unique identities. So people can relate to that and start to develop some sort of attachment to them. And this is an easier and most fundamental problem to deal with than we can imagine. Because the traditional strategies to build identities used by most urbanists are to build things. Let's build things and people will come. We'll build a whole city, we'll build a stadium, we'll build a Guggenheim Museum, and people will come to the city. And the result is Brasilia, which is lovely for architects, but for architects only. And it doesn't work well because all the suburbs of Brasilia are crowded with slums because they don't fit in this great idea of a great architect. So we believe that urban intervention is great, but it usually takes time and lots of resources. It's a bet, and it's a very expensive bet. It is subject to political demands. It can change the political party, it can change the mayor, and it can be postponed or even stopped. And all these things may compromise project development. So you're going to spend a lot of money to something that may not work. Like this huge ship anchored in Bilbao. And people didn't go more to Bilbao. They went to see the museum and then went back. So it's a sort of an enclave inside of Bilbao. So how can we build that? Well, we believe that we should flip things. We should turn things upside down. We believe that grassroots urbanism is a much better way to develop the city identity. And what is this? Well, we've got the example from one of the most creative countries in the world, which is India. It has this.
Mr. Jockman has lived in the slums for 50 years, built a million houses and toilets, been nominated for a Nobel Peace Prize, and brought his organization, Slum Dwellers International, to 43 different countries.
We don't need Bluetooth to come and sit on my head and dance. I know how to write my song. It is my dance, my song, I will play it.
He's basically saying, we got this. If you want to help, channel your support through us. For example, here's a cell phone recycling operation in Jockman's neighborhood. We all want to be involved in the futures of the places where we live.
We won't see every city in the world. All is being planned by very, very super well-known, renowned architect and philosopher and so on and so forth. He has lost all the sense of hearing from the people.
Which is the most important thing. So what we suggest? We suggest communication strategies, reversing this kind of process so we can enable grassroots urbanism. How does it work? I want two parts. First, we build a communication strategy to understand the citizen's view and perspectives of that city. We can't tell the citizen what the city is. We should hear them, to understand from them what they want that the city should be. And after that, we can build a public dialogue that is an ongoing conversation and participatory. with the city development. So what do you want your city to be? Do you want your city to be a communications hub? Do you want your city to be a new Los Angeles? Do you want your city to be an educational hub? Okay, you're going to pay for it. It won't be cheap, and it will take lots of years. So I'm really sure, because we're going to gamble with your bet, not with our bet anymore. And we believe that engagement is key, and today is the day for that. Because in the social media world, everybody is speaking. Everybody is using the worst kind of media to express their opinions about almost everything. People use YouTube, people use Twitter, people use Medium, people use blogs, people invent words in Twitter, and people say whatever they want, which is wonderful. This guy uses Twitter, which is not an official communication channel, but it works. So we believe that this practice is essential in smart cities. If we develop a dialogue-based, why smart cities? Because smart cities can be a very, very, very big problem. Because if we start the dialogue, then we will help everyone to interact and everyone to demand changes from the smart cities. Let me show you what can happen if we don't do that. Because this is what makes sense, and what makes sense usually doesn't happen. So what will happen? Well, first we have to undo the idea of city concepts. Because when we have smart cities, we freeze the dynamics into the codes and the processes. So if we have the idea that this city is an entrepreneurial hub, it will be frozen in the city code, and nobody can see that. I can read a newspaper and imagine and read from this newspaper that this newspaper is left-wing, or it's right-wing, or it's traditional, or it's modern, or it's anything. I can't read that in code. Even if I code, I can't understand the ideology of code. So we have to start the dialogue before code, and code is running fast. Smart cities will become data crashes. Which is that? Well, see, just like democracy is a regime. And what kind of regime is that? Well, it can be an open regime, it can be a democratic one, it can be an oligarchic one, it can be a closed dictatorship, it can be 1984, it can be Blade Runner, it can be almost anything. It's just a regime like any other. So people are talking about smart cities, and they don't seem to realize that they are talking about a new form of government. So we have a choice. Either we have a technopolis, which is a city with technology, or we have a technopoly, which is a term coined by a new postman in 1982, which is a society which technology is deified. It's a new god. The culture seeks its authorization in technology, finds its satisfactions in technology, and takes its orders from technology. Now think about your smartphone. You don't need the processing power that's equivalent of three times the Apollo project. And that's what you have in your pocket. And that's what you change almost every year. So it's technology demanding from you what you want, and now everybody's is going to some sort of rapture, which is the artificial intelligence and singularity and things like that. So we believe that we have to hear from people, and this feedback should be structural. So cities have to be open, understanding, and tolerant as part of their fundamental code. And how can this be done? It's not a topic, it's simple. First, we develop communication-centered strategies, which every public servant, every public employee should report their actions, not only their salaries or their posts, but their actions to the general public. Open data, APIs, and easy prototyping tools for everyone to understand what is being done. We only care about politics once in every 2 or 4 years when we vote, and then we forget about it. It is the most important decision that we take in our lives. It should be inclusive. Inclusive. Half of the population doesn't access the internet, which means half of the population of the world is stuck in the 20th century. and which job someone from the 20th century will find today. Because if you don't access the internet, you're in 1999, you depend on magazines, on television, on radio. So we have to give technology, interactive tools, in public kiosks, mobile tools for the smartphones, accessible for most people, including the elderly, the poor, and everyone outside the smartphone range. Because everybody thinks about apps. Apps. They usually get to 40 to 80% of the population. What about the rest? It should be global. Immigration shouldn't be a problem, but a part of the solution. If we have a global, since we have remote meetings, we have Skype meetings, we have Skype calls, Skype love, why don't we have Skype citizenship? It should be simple. And let me give you an example, just simple. Most interventions are big picture, which are complex, dynamic, and utopic. I say, we're going to develop a new Airbus system, self-driving buses, and things like that. Just things that are a lot easier. Think about the Google Maps interface. Imagine that this is the interface of a kiosk in your bus stop. And every day, when you take the bus, you try to experiment with the route of the bus. They say, why does this bus take this road when nobody gets up there? So someone tries to drag and change the route of the bus. And after the public administration, after seeing that once, twice, three times, 20 times, 100 times, 10,000 times, you say, hey, everybody is preferring route A to route B. Why should we keep route B just because some specialists have developed? And people who take the bus and spend 3 or 4 hours every day on the bus are telling them otherwise that this could be faster and that would be more efficient. So why not use it? And everybody can use that. So it's not to develop something that's completely new. It's just giving the interface that people are used to use to the new technologies. Just let me remind you one thing that happened with SMS. When SMS started, messaging was a thing of the poor. Everybody had iPhones and used email, or had Blackberries and used email, while the poor people used SMS in numerical keyboards. And why did they use that? Because it was cheap and because it was efficient. So it is nonsense to say that the poor are dumb or anything like that. The only thing that the poor are is short of money. Out of that, they are exactly equal to everyone else. It should be ongoing. Huh? Feedback and response should be a part of everyday civic life. Every time we open a feedback channel to the public administration and say, but we will be flooded with complaints. Well, it's just like if you never brush your teeth. You will be flooded with cavities. But if you brush your teeth every day, you don't have this problem anymore. So if you open a feedback channel, of course it would be a sewage drain, but after 2 days, 4 days, 2 months, 4 years, 10 years, it's going to be a part of everyday life. It should be free, and free for everyone. And it should be. All the technology that's needed for that already exists. We're using that. And we are thinking about self-driving drones, we're thinking about new code, we're thinking about teaching people to think like and talk like machines, while everything they need, they already have. So why don't you go use them? Thank you.